It's good to see each one of you today. Glad you could be out for our service this morning. Please take your hymnals and turn to page 74. Page 74, Praise to the Lord the Almighty.
Praise to the Lord the Almighty.
This morning to the Community Bible Church of Holly Springs. We want to welcome those of you that are visiting us with us for the first time. It's good to see y'all. It's good to know that none of y'all floated away all this rain we had this week. So welcome. By way of announcements, tonight in the 5:30 p.m. fellowship service, Dr. Chuck continues his series in Proverbs. CBC Kids will also meet for their class time. Next Sunday, May 26th, we will honor and celebrate our graduates during our fourth Sunday fellowship meal following the morning service. On Monday, May 27th, you are invited to the Davenport home for Memorial Day picnic and lake activities, 11 to 5 p.m. Please sign up today if you are attending. Grilled chicken and drinks are provided. Sign up for sides and desserts via Perfect Potluck link and church email. Please see sign-up sheet for more information. The latest precept Bible study continues this Friday, 9:30 a.m. in the sanctuary. And remember, mark your calendars. VBS is coming quickly, June 10th through the 14th. Online registration link is available through Facebook or through our website, cbchs.org. Let's open in prayer. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for this great day you've given to us, Father, and we thank you that we can come and worship in freedom, Father. And I pray for this election year, I pray that you would appoint those to leadership who you would have. And I pray that those that are in office will fear you, Father. I pray that as your word goes forth throughout the world today, that believers will be encouraged in you, and that those that don't know you will come to a saving knowledge of you. I pray for all the needs that are represented this morning in this assembly, that you would answer those according to your will and in your time. I pray for Pastor Dan as he brings your word to us, that we don't only listen with open ears but open hearts, and that we be ready to be a blessing to those we interact with this week. Bless this time together in Jesus' name. Amen.
For 71 next, a prayerful song with a beautiful melody, Lord of My Heart.
Today's scripture reading will be taken from Colossians chapter 3, 1 through 17. Colossians 3, starting with the first verse. If then you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on the earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Put to death, therefore, what is earthly in you: sexual immorality, impurity, passion, evil desire, and covetousness, which is idolatry. On account of these things, the wrath of God is coming. In these you too once walked when you were living in them, but now you must put them all away: anger, wrath, malice, slander, and obscene talk from your mouth. Do not lie to one another, seeing that you have put off the old self with its practices, and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge after the image of its creator. Here there is not Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave, free, but Christ is all and in all. Put on, then, as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience, bearing with one another, and if one has a complaint against another, forgiving each other as the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. And above all these, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. And whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Amen. May the Lord bless the reading of his word this morning. I'd ask men to come forward for the offering now. And Rex, would you open us in prayer?
Let's pray. Our Father, Lord, we thank you, Father, for bringing us to your church, Lord, this morning. Help us, Father, as we hear your word. Help us, Father, to listen intently. Take away all our distractions and sins, Lord, that we may hear you clearly, Lord, and understand. Help us, Father, through your Holy Spirit, guide us and give us understanding. Help us to do your will, Lord, and thank you, Father, that we have your word to rely on, Lord. And again, we thank you, Father, for your goodness and your mercy, Lord, and help us to have unity. Help us to love one another, Lord, and help us to know, Father, that you are our jealous God, a loving God, a righteous God. So help us to know that in our hearts, in our minds, in our soul. Thank you again, Father, for your church. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
He leadeth me. Thank you, Karen. That ties in nicely with our next song, I Will Follow. Notice the verse there under the song title, My sheep hear my voice and I know them and they follow me, from John 10:27. Let me invite you to stand, please, as we sing 442 together.
Good morning, everyone.
Morning.
I'm glad that you're here today. If your Bible falls open to Hebrews, that's a good place to start, because we're just back a page in Philemon. So Philemon chapter 1. I thought after a year and a half, your Bible would just open to Hebrews, maybe. So we're close. But let me mention several things regarding our schedule. Not necessarily in order, but as they come to my mind here. VBS, we are 3 weeks away from VBS. And so there's much that still needs to be done. So pray for us. Pray for those involved. Pray that I think we have 13 or 14 already registered early in that process now. But we anticipate a good number, and we want all those the Lord would have be with us this summer for our VBS program. But do pray for us that we would get everything ready to go. And also, next Sunday, fourth Sunday meal. It seems like we just had one. The year is quickly leaving us. We're approaching midway through the year. Next Sunday, not only will we have our fourth Sunday fellowship meal, but we'll also honor our graduates. We have several. There's an email that you should have received about our graduates. So we'll honor them next Sunday after the service and our fellowship meal. So remember that. And then next weekend's Memorial Day weekend. So Monday, you have been invited to the Davenport home. They have sailboat, speedboat, lake property, outdoor activities. They're providing food, and so they've invited all of us to attend. So we're grateful for them, to them for opening up their home. And I want to remind you about that. I do believe the meal is at 12 o'clock. It is they will provide grilled chicken and drinks and everything you need. There's a perfect potluck web page for sign up. So if you plan on attending, we do need to know this week so that plans can be made properly. So was there a sign up sheet in the... There should have been, but there probably wasn't because, as I recall, I didn't print that out. So I will have that following the service. In fact, I think we'll probably just put a blank piece of paper out there with an ink pen, and you put your name and how many people you are bringing, and we'll assume that that is for next Monday at the Davenport's home. If you have any questions, then contact Rick or Barbara or any of the elders should be able to field questions or to get you to the right people with information. So that's next Monday. So busy week, busy time of year, and certainly with VBS coming up, continue to pray for that. All right, here we go. Let me prepare everything. Philemon, I'd like to read just the verses 1 through 7 here as we primarily look at verses 4 through 7. I have been guilty of considering the book of Philemon to be primarily about Onesimus. And we haven't even been introduced to this character, though we've mentioned him last week in an introduction. And we won't be again today in the scriptures that we read. He is later on. We're going to be primarily dealing with this person, this man Philemon. It's a great study, and I think it'll be worth our time together as we look at verses 4 through 7 today. But let's begin at the beginning of the book, Philemon, verse 1, and we will read together through verse number 7. You follow along. Paul, a prisoner for Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our beloved fellow worker, and Apphia, our sister, and Archippus, our fellow soldier, and the church in your house, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God always when I remember you in my prayers, because I hear of your love and of the faith that you have toward the Lord Jesus and for all the saints. And I pray that the sharing of your faith may become effective for the full knowledge of every good thing that is in us for the sake of Christ. For I have derived much joy and comfort from your love, my brother, because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you. Well, let's have a word of prayer and then we'll begin this morning. Father, we pause now to ask for the greatest thing we need at this point. And we have already heard from your word. Now we need, Lord, to hear from you. And so as your word is powerful and alive and effective in our hearts, so your spirit today speaks, urges, encourages, comforts, walks alongside us, brings things to our attention, calls truth to our minds so that we may actually hear from you today. We pray that each person here would have an open heart and an attitude that is receptive to your word today. And Father, we're thankful for the word. We're thankful for the truths that have been kept for us in these pages. And we pray that our time would be profitable as we are guided along by your word and by your spirit. For we ask these things in the name of Christ our Lord. Amen. This morning we're simply going to look at who is this Philemon. We have learned in the previous introduction to this that he was a man, perhaps a husband and a father. Many commentaries jump to this, that he had a wife and son, and that is the Apphia and Archippus there mentioned in the first and second verse. However, we're not certain of that, but we do know also that he had some amount of wealth and property, and that he had a church house in on his property there, a group of believers who were gathering together. And we know that he had servants. And so while this does give us an idea of who this man was, I'm more encouraged by verses 4 through 7 in giving us an idea of who this man was. He really was an interesting character, and I would say a model for all believers. We are to follow Christ, and we are to follow those who follow Christ. And here we are given a prime example of this individual who Philemon gives to us a pattern that we can follow. Now, beginning of verse number 4, we have Paul's greeting here. As he often does in many of his books, he has words of encouragement, words that he is praying for these group of believers. He is mentioning what he has heard about them. And in many ways, it's very encouraging, very positive to read. Thessalonians, one of my favorite introductions to a church group, a group of believers, that is found in the New Testament Scripture. But here we again have an idea of Paul's heart, not only for Philemon, but for those in the church that is in Colossae. And so he mentions verse 4, I thank my God always when I remember you in my prayers. Now, this says a lot about Paul. We're going to find in verses 4 through 7 the way Paul was impacted, the way others were impacted, and the way Philemon was the one who was impacting them. And so it's very specific here. It's very easy to work through. Paul says, I thank my God always when I remember you in my prayers. Now, this is a statement worth thinking about. Number one, it reminds us that Paul practices what he preaches in praying for others. And we are encouraged as believers to pray one for another. And so I trust that we are doing that, that we're actively praying and considering one another in our prayers. There are many ways that you can do this. Some of you may have a prayer list. You have a sheet that's organized. Some use the hand method. I don't know if you've heard this, but the hand method. So you put up the fingers and you think of those who are closest to you and those the longest or tallest and those have authority and the smallest, the weakest. However you do it, there have been a number of ways that through my own life that I have used the method of praying for others. For example, pretty much, as I look out among the congregation, you are, generally speaking, sitting in about the same place. Whether that's by design or not, it is what it is. It's the truth. And so often when after Friday's ladies' study, we have tables set up and chairs and some of the auditorium has been rearranged for other activities, as I set up the chairs, I can close my eyes, or leave my eyes open, basically, and I can recall where you're sitting. And so that is a way that I have used in the past to pray for others. There are lists and things. Many of you have given gifts, and I'm always appreciative of gifts that you give, but for one reason I learned years ago is that every time I see that gift, I think of you, and it gives me an opportunity to pause and to pray for you. There are other ways that we can use this idea of praying one for another, but Paul actually puts that into practice. But that's not what he's saying here. He's not commanding that we ought to pray. He is mentioning that when I pray regarding Philemon, he says, I thank my God always. Now, that's a different matter. It's one thing to pray for people. It's another thing to say that every time I think of you in my prayers, I give thanks to God. Thursday morning, I was traveling, running some errands. I had just local radio on. I was shocked by the news story, not the initial aspect of it. A Asheville, North Carolina man was arrested. He picked up for larceny and several outstanding warrants that he had. But as the story continued, that they began to share information. I had to look it up because I was not sure that I heard it properly. This individual was arrested earlier last year, served about a year in time in jail or whatever, and was released this last February, so 4 or 5 months ago. He was released again for the same, he had been arrested twice since his release in February. So that's two more times he had been arrested. And then here was the statement that I had to look up to make sure I heard it right. Since 1992, law enforcement has charged this Nesbitt individual at least 114 times. So in a 32-year criminal career, I mean, he has made a career out of it, I think we could all agree, he's been arrested and charged 114 times. Habitual. I thought this week, I thought, what comes to my mind when I heard that story was that there are a lot of people that when they close their eyes and this man comes into the picture screen, it is met with a burden, with concern, with shame, with some level of hesitation, and certainly a heaviness. Now think about that. That is not what we want to encourage in our community, in our families, that a person would be known for being a repeat offender. But when I think about the opposite here, I think this goes to the other extreme. Paul says, you know, every time I close my eyes and I think of you in prayer, you know, I give thanks to God for you. And there is a reason why. It is not just Paul ignoring what was a reality, but notice verse 5. He gives us the because. I thank my God always when I remember you in my prayers, because I hear of your love and of the faith that you have toward the Lord Jesus and for all the saints. In other words, there was a reason why Paul, when he considered Philemon as a friend, as a fellow worker, as a minister in the gospel, that he would close his eyes, think of Philemon, and give thanks to God for him, because he was a repeat encourager, a repeat comforter. He was a repeat refresher. Later on, he says that the hearts of the saints have been refreshed, and I, verse 7, myself, have derived much joy and comfort from you. So this Philemon was an individual whose impact on those around us was a positive one. That is just a reminder, but I thought how refreshing these kind of people are. Those who don't let air out of your sail, burst the balloon or pop the bubble around you, they encourage, they give life. It's like a drink of water. It's like a breath of fresh air when they are around you. And so I thought of that. And in this passage, there are two passages, or there are two verses here. This statement in verse number 5, when I hear of your love and of the faith, there's a couplet there, that you have toward the Lord Jesus and for all the saints. It's given people a little difficulty. This is the first of two such instances in this passage. Let's look at the first. When I hear of your love and faith that you have toward the Lord Jesus and for all the saints. Well, do we separate these out, or do we connect them all together? In other words, we think of an A and B sequence. I hear of your love. Well, love toward who? Well, if we jump to the second statement, it's the Lord Jesus Christ. And then we see here of the faith. That's the second thing. And if we jump to the B in the couplet that ends the verse, we have for all the saints. So people say we really shouldn't have love for Jesus and faith toward the saints. It should be the opposite way. We should have love for the saints and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. Now this is a This is a possible Greek syntax or rendering, a use of the language. For example, Matthew 12:22, Jesus, after healing, the statement goes, "The blind and dumb," remember the AB sequence, "the blind and the dumb both spake and saw." So if we use the same logic or reasoning in that verse, then the blind man, he spoke. That was a miracle. Well, the dumb man saw. It is a reversal. The A goes with the B goes with the A, and so it is a technique used. Now, that is one way of understanding this passage. We have love for the saints. We have faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. Both those things are scriptural. Both those things are taught in the passage. But I think there are several commentators and several translations that connect the two as a cause and effect. J.B. Phillips writes this, "I have heard how you love and trust both the Lord Jesus and all the saints." And in that way, I think that it can be helpful to us. Not that we put people on the same level of our trust that we have toward our God and our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. But as we think about community, we think about being one of another, and in this together, I think love and trust ought to be demonstrated both toward our God and our Savior, Jesus Christ, as well as one to another. And so, verse 20 of John, 1 John chapter 4, "If anyone says, 'I love God,' and hates his brother, he is a liar. For he who does not love his brother whom he has seen cannot love God whom he has not seen. And this commandment we have from him: whoever loves God must also love his brother." So we are encouraged here with this concept of loving our brother. Some will say, exactly, "I can see my brother, and that's why I don't love him." Now this will get to the heart of this passage and this book. Because I want to set aside the love and faith aspect and get to the second difficult, challenging, or misunderstood portion of this passage of Scripture. In fact, the way I have it in the notes, we're going to jump to verse number 7 here, because Paul says, "I have derived much joy and comfort from your love, my brother, because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you." Now, we've already seen that. But now let's focus on verse number 6. In this prayer and in this thanksgiving that Paul is giving, he is asking something specific, and that is found in verse number 6. So let's take a look at verse number 6. "And I pray that the sharing of your faith may become effective for the full knowledge of every good thing that is in us for the sake of Christ." It is natural and understandable to focus on this first phrase, the sharing of your faith. You see it there at the introduction, the sharing of your faith, or perhaps the communication of your faith, as is translated. And that is to come away from this passage and to encourage individual believers to be active in personal evangelism. That is, share your faith. That is a phrase I think that all throughout my, if you're in church any amount of time growing up, you hear these statements and they are automatically connected to a specific truth. So sharing your faith is often directly associated with witnessing, with evangelism, with opening and telling others the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so we see this verse here dealing with sharing your faith. And so there was a time that I probably would have opened to Philemon, verse number 6, without any context of what was before or any context of what was after, and encouraged you to be a person who shares your faith verbally, openly, to others, so that in sharing the faith, they might be aware of the power of the gospel and come to a knowledge and a fuller, deeper understanding of the gospel message. And I would have had verse 6 as the authority. Having a different study method now than perhaps many years ago, and coming to this verse 6 in connection with the rest of the context of the passage, it is interesting what commentators write about verse number 6. Nearly every word in verse number 6 has a disputed rendering. In other words, the way we translate each of these words in verse number 6 often depends on and is determined by the surrounding words and the way they are interpreted. Well, here we have such a collection of words that are all interdependent, so that the true meaning of this verse is variously translated. Let's go back to the screen. I figured I would just let you figure it out. You're smart people. You have a Bible, right? And you have a brain, as I've often heard it said. So there you go. This is the Greek. This would be the original language. And so I did want to take a moment here and promote several truths. Number one, in my education of the Scriptures and of the Word of God and translation, there have been two words that have been heavily emphasized, and I think they are important words, and I want you to be fully aware of them. The first word is inspiration, and the second word is preservation. Now, what is meant by these words? Inspiration is the idea that God gave us the words, that they were not the invention of men, they didn't come out of the mind of man, they were not... The Word of God is not a human book. It is not a humanly manufactured book. That what we have and what we call the Word of God was given to us by God. That He used men who spake as they were carried along by the Spirit of God. So that again, when we talk about the power of the Word, and when we talk about being humble before the Word and servants to the book, we're not bowing before a man or a group of men who gave us this Word. We bow before the God of heaven, the God of creation, who has miraculously given to us His Word. And again, what is the Word of God? Is it a combination or a collection of everything God knows? No, it is what God wants us to know. And so we are given this by inspiration of God. Timothy writes about that in the second book, chapter 3, verses 15 and 16. The second word is preservation. The couplet is always kept together because what good would inspiration be without preservation? In other words, if God gave to David, to Moses, to Paul, to John, and to Peter, and the other writers of Scripture, if He gave to them His Word, what good would it be if He did not keep those words for us? This is an amazing study. I hope you've taken the time to familiarize yourself with it. The vast collection of manuscripts and the copies of Scripture that we have kept for us today. It really is an amazing thing to see that God not only gave us His Word, but He's kept His Word for us. And so inspiration, important. Preservation, important. Little, though, was said about the third word that I'm going to give to you. And if you just look at the screen, you'll see that it's obviously a big one, and that is translation. Because unless you want to spend a significant amount of time learning Hebrew and Greek, this is what you and I would be staring at without translations. And so thank God for those men and women who give themselves to the task of working to translate for us the Word of God. Now, I bring all of that up because I want you to see how this verse is variously translated among scriptures. The ESV, and I pray that the sharing of your faith may become effective for the full knowledge of every good thing that is in us for the sake of Christ. Now, I don't want to get off on this, but if you're curious, this is not a word for word, point for point. Every word here in our English translation is matched to a word in the Greek text. This is not the way the translation works. It is a very complex deal. But the key words here would be translated in the ESV: sharing, faith, effective, full knowledge, every good thing in us, and the sake of Christ, or the sake of Jesus Christ. And so I want you to pay attention how the Authorized Version, King James Version, translates it differently, and among others. So I pray that the sharing of your faith may become effective for the full knowledge of every good thing that is in us for the sake of Christ. And let me just note here that you could still stick with the idea of witnessing and evangelism here in this verse. But what if you read the Authorized Version? That the communication of thy faith may become effectual by the acknowledging of every good thing which is in you in Christ Jesus. Well, again, it seems to have the idea of speech, language, or communication. The New International Version, I pray that your partnership with us in the faith may be effective in deepening your understanding of every good thing we share for the sake of Christ. Here, what's this idea of partnership and where did it come from? Partnering with us. The New Living Translation, and I am praying that you will put into action the generosity that comes from your faith as you understand and experience all the good things we have in Christ. Putting into action the generosity. Holman Christian Standard, I pray that your participation in the faith may become effective. The American Standard, that the fellowship of thy faith may become effectual. Let's look one more. I pray that the fellowship of your faith may become effective in the knowledge of every good thing that is in us for Christ. And here we return to the ESV, the sharing of your faith. Let's move on here. Let's not get bogged down with this. But you can see by the multiple ways of translating this passage that there is something bigger, a bigger idea than just opening your mouth and sharing the gospel. We have had words like communication and sharing, but we've also had words of partnership, of participation, and of fellowship. And the reason is that the Greek word here is the word koinonia. It's the word for fellowship. It has the idea of unity, of partnering, or of participation, of sharing together, of everyone being involved. It is the idea of community here. And so I think that is why it is good and helpful that we understand the multiple ways that this is translated, so that we don't lock into one idea of simply sharing our faith. Now, I'm not saying that you should not share your faith, but I think there's something more important here as we come to this passage, when we understand he's talking about the koinonia, the fellowship of the believers in Christ, and that partnering together, that participation together, that work together, that idea of sharing and community, that is what he wants to focus on, that it may become effective for the full knowledge of every good thing that is in us for the sake of Christ. So that as we understand who we are And what we have in Christ Jesus, not only with our relationship to God, but our standing between one another, that it would cause us to increase our understanding and deepen our knowledge in what we have in Christ Jesus. Now, why is that important? It's important here because I think the context of this book. Let's go back to our Asheville individual. I had several aha moments this week as I was hit with the contrasting Philemon and his habitual refresher and encourager, and this individual in Asheville. Aha number one. Have I prayed for this individual? And how would I pray for him? It's a good question, right? Yeah, it really, really struck me early on as I was considering the contrast. I thought, you know, it would be helpful if I would just stop and pray that God would allow his eyes to be open to the gospel. Yes. That was aha moment number one. Aha moment number two, when a day or two later, I began to consider what actions I would then take regarding his life and well-being if he responded to the gospel. Are you following this? Here's an individual. Obviously, as a friend of mine would say, he needs the Lord. He needs Christ in his life. This lifestyle of just wanting and collecting what is not his for satisfaction or for enjoyment, whatever his reasoning is, there's something missing in his life. And I think we all know that that is the knowledge of Christ Jesus our Lord. So I ought to pray for him. But what if he did respond to the gospel? How then would I treat him? This is where the fellowship of the gospel causes us to increase in our knowledge and our understanding of every good thing we have in Jesus Christ. Because we still today continue and insist upon living life and granting forgiveness and granting welcome and granting reconciliation to those who deserve it. When a brother meets the criteria that I have set up in order to welcome him into the fellowship of believers, then I will gladly extend that to him. And I think this is why our understanding of verse number 6 is that we should not just be talking about the community of faith as it relates to believers in Christ Jesus, but we ought to put it into practice. And that Paul's praying that in the community here in Colossae, everyone would be fully aware of what the power of the gospel means, not only with my eternal standing before God, but my relationship between and among the brothers and sisters. Here's the plain, here's the bottom line. How are we going to address this thief, this runaway who has wronged you? That's the book of Philemon. And that's what he's, I think, setting up here in verse number 6. We understand that there's a fellowship of community of believers that can fully understand in a greater way, in a deeper way, in a more understanding way, all that we have in Jesus Christ, not by merely talking about the gospel and how it creates in us equal footing, but by putting it to practice. Because here is someone who has wronged him, perhaps taken what does not belong to him, run away, and Paul is going to be asking Philemon to treat him as a brother. And so before we ever get to the bulk of this letter and the plea in verse number 8, I think Paul here is setting a seed. Like, I'm about to ask you to do something that people aren't going to understand. I'm about to ask you to do something that might go beyond your own reasoning abilities. I'm going to ask you to do something on the sake or by the sake of the gospel. Because this one who was useless before is now useful. Because he, like us, is a fellow believer, a fellow soldier, and a fellow member of the household of faith. This is encouraging to us that when Paul prayed for Philemon, he prayed that he would put into action so that he could understand greater. Let me tell you that there's nothing that causes us to understand the gospel more fully than when we understand that it is a gospel for everyone. When there are individuals who, because of hairstyle or activities or lifestyle, is not worthy of your gospel, you are the one with the problem, not them. You ever think about this? I said this. I won't get into names. But think about the guy you think is the last person God would ever let into his heaven. And I'm telling you, that is the first guy on the list of the gospel. Amen. It ought to be. We misunderstand the gospel when we think it's only for good people, only for people who are halfway there. Christ can take you the other half, but you got to meet him halfway. And this is a prominent, prevalent teaching in the gospel. You meet him, he'll meet you. God helps those who help themselves. And so you need to work and prove your worth to God. I love what Paul said. Paul is our example in the faith in many ways. And he said, the mercy that God showed to me was for multiple reasons, but primarily so that all who want to come to faith would have access to it. Paul said, I was the chief. I persecuted the church. I denied the faith that I was attacking. I had no... Paul was dead set against Jesus Christ and the church that followed him. Pretty good candidate for the judgment of God, right? But the gospel message reaches all. I love the way Revelation concludes. To all who are thirsty, the message is, come, drink of the water of life, which is given freely. To whosoever that believes, to anyone who is thirsty. Set aside the doctrine and the idea of election for a moment and follow the apostles' pattern all throughout the New Testament. Whosoever will may come. They went to the religious Jews. They went to the wicked Gentiles. Why? Because the gospel is for everyone who will call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And once they do, they are as righteous as Jesus Christ himself is righteous, because Christ's righteousness is imputed to us. I'm not good, and I'm not on my way to heaven, and I'm not any one of importance in your eyes or anyone else's eyes other than the fact that I am forgiven, I am redeemed, I have been justified, that is, declared righteous in the sight of God. Mm-hmm. Romans 8, If God is for us and he's the one who justifies us, who's going to be the one to condemn us? Who's it going to be? And this Onesimus, even though things did not go well in his relationship with Philemon initially, Paul is going to ask him, hey, because of the gospel, because of faith in Christ, he is to be treated as a brother. Paul says, I want you to receive him just as you would receive me. And so in this passage, we see the prayer encouraging believers, you and I, to live out our faith among one another. It leaves no room for selfish ambition. It leaves no room for preferential elevation of certain individuals. Forgiveness, reconciliation, it is the work that God has given us to do. And we're to do that in love. And here we see another example of it. Well, that is the initial encouragement there to Philemon. But what a character, Philemon. And I pray that that would be a model, that when we are around others, that we would be someone who continually, repeatedly leaves them encouraged and refreshed in the Lord. May God help us to do so. Father, thank you again for our time in your word. Thank you for the scriptures as we have looked at them today. Father, help us to share with our lips the good news of the gospel to those who are without the gospel and those who are outside of the community of faith. But Father, help us also to walk and talk and live and breathe the gospel message in our communities so that we would prefer one another, so that we would treat one another in kindness and humility, that we would forgive one another, even as God, for the sake of Christ, has forgiven us. And Father, may we never be guilty of excusing unforgiveness and withholding that from a brother or sister in Christ because we think we deserve and they don't. Father, give us wisdom in our interpersonal relationships. Give us wisdom as we walk together in this life. Lord, give us wisdom as we await the day that you return in power and glory. We ask all these things in Christ's name. Amen.
As we close, let's turn to 276, please. 276, Jesus Paid It All. And please stand with me as we sing.
To him I owe. left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. And when before the throne I stand in him complete, Jesus died my soul to save.
Good to have you here this morning. If you have a restful afternoon, well, many of you can return for our study in Proverbs this evening.